Let me play you a brief excerpt of Donald Trump himself. This is from the State of the Union address this past January.
This will be my first time to hear.
It's something I'm very proud of. African-American unemployment stands at the lowest rate ever recorded.
Okay.
Oh, my.
He produces a statistic. Maybe the statistic isn't quite right either. Maybe
no, it is.
It is.
Yes.
And there you see a shot. You see Republicans standing and applauding. And there you see a shot of Democrats who are sitting on their hands, including many members of the Black Caucus.
Yes.
In Congress. What do you make of that?
That, as with so many other groups around the world, the leaders of groups that are lagging are often themselves one of the biggest handicaps of those groups.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Dennis Prager Show. I say with absolute candor and sincerity, one of the greatest living thinkers, certainly in my lifetime. And he is Tom Sowell, well known to many of you, should be known to everybody in America. Senior fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford. His new book was published yesterday, and it is Charter Schools and Their Enemies. I read his piece in the Wall Street Journal on this subject. Tom, welcome back to my show.
Good being back.
Thank you, sir. Where are you cooped up these days?
Cooped up at home as I usually am. I mean, the pandemic has not made nearly as much difference in my lifestyle as in the lifestyle of most other people.
But you haven't been able to go around doing photography.
Well, I can, but the work has been overwhelming, really, for much of the past 2 years. Partly because I realized how important the book was, not simply as a book, but whether it can let a large number of people understand what the situation is with charter schools and the dangers, as there's been a big political backlash against charter schools, reflected last year in some very strong anti-charter school legislation in California that will make it virtually impossible for charter schools to suspend disruptive students.
I felt foolish that I had not realized this, but if I didn't realize it, I assume many didn't. I knew the argument given, charter schools, of course they do better because they skim the best students from the general population. And then you had a great answer. I'll let you give the answer.
Well, first of all, charter schools select their students through a lottery.
Yes,
they know nothing about who is the best student. They don't have their academic records. They don't have any test scores. It's the luck of the draw. Now, there is some element of selectivity in the sense that students who are serious or whose parents are serious will be entered into the lottery. And so the lottery as students may be a notch above in motivation, all right? What they leave out is the crucial point. Most people who enter a lottery do not win. Some fraction win. And the majority of those motivated students remain in the public schools. For example, 1 year there were 17,000 applicants for 3,000 places in the Success Academy charter school network. The Success Academy took 3,000. 14,000 were left for the traditional public schools. Now, you know, they could have educated those 14,000 just as well as the charter school educated the 3,000. They didn't choose to do so.
Your title is "And Their Enemies." Who are the biggest enemies?
The teachers' unions, politicians, people who are still fighting the battle for racial integration that started with Brown v. Board, who think that they ought to be deciding where black kids and Hispanic kids go rather than the parents of those children. For example, last year there were more than 50,000 students in New York City on waiting lists to get into charter schools. Now, if those 50,000 students can get into a charter school with a per-pupil allotment of more than $20,000 apiece, we're talking about more than $1 billion a year being transferred out of the traditional public schools and into the charter schools. People who run the traditional public schools try their best to make sure that does not happen. And there are a number of ways, not all of them legal, that they can do that.
So I'll bet a lot of people listening have a vague idea of what a charter school is. So would you define it?
Yes, it's a public school in the sense that the taxpayers pay for it, and there's no tuition or anything. But it's a public school set up by people outside the education establishment, private people, who agree to various terms as the condition of having a charter issued that will allow them to receive students from the public school system and to receive the money to educate the students.
Right. So the teachers' union will argue, we're shifting, let's say, $1 billion over to charter schools. Who then theoretically loses the $1 billion? You have to hire teachers for charter schools, too.
Oh, charter school teachers, most of those are not unionized. And the teachers' union represent those particular teachers who are in the traditional public school system. The public school bureaucrats don't like the idea of $1 billion disappearing because they have their bureaucratic empires. And then they're going to have fewer jobs to give out and so forth. One of the most ridiculous arguments is one that is most often used, namely, they're draining money from the public schools. They can't drain anything. They can only enroll students who volunteer or whose parents volunteer them. The question that immediately comes to mind is, did you seriously think that when a child moves from school A to school B, the money to educate him should stay behind in school B? I mean, it's insane when you stop and think about it. But the fact that that argument is still effective for some people suggests there are a lot of people out there who are not in the habit of stopping and thinking about it.
Right. But money, but in reality, money is being drained from unions. That's the teachers' union. Is that accurate?
No. It's the money that pays the teachers' salaries and the salaries of a whole army of other people, or perhaps more than is paid to the teachers. But I guess it's to me at least the simplicity of it that is overlooked. That what is happening is the kids go from school A to school B. The money goes from school A to school B. That happens if he's only transferring to a different district in the same city.
Right, but there's again. I just for my clarity, I want to just be very clear for me.
Okay.
They oppose it, the teachers' unions, and that's all that matters, because they won't have unionized teachers in charter schools.
That's right.
Okay. What does that mean? That means fewer dues are paid to teachers' unions.
Yes, and teachers' union dues are measured in the billions nationwide.
It's an astonishing thing. All right, so let me ask an overarching question. In light of the fact that a lot of black parents, like anybody else, care about their children's education, and in light of the fact that the Democrats oppose better education for black children and Republicans are for it, why blacks overwhelmingly vote Democrat is the question.
Well, the information that's in this book, simple as it may be, is simply not that widely known. I don't know how many parents in Harlem know that the mayor of New York is bitterly opposed to charter schools, says so in words of one syllable, and it says so all throughout his career. So they may be happy with their charter school or dissatisfied with their traditional public school, either way. And until they know what is going on. Moreover, not everybody knows how the two kinds of schools are effective or not effective in education. That's one of the reasons I have, tables for more than 100 individual schools in New York City where traditional public schools and charter schools educate kids in the very same building, serving the very same community, so you can get comparable students to make your comparison. But most of these things, most of this stuff is unknown. It shouldn't be unknown, but it is.
Why is a charter school better?
There are any number of reasons.
All right, wait. Tell me when we come back. I want to remind everybody. My guest is one of the most important thinkers of my lifetime, Thomas Sowell. And his latest book is Charter Schools and Their Enemies. So where were we, Tom Sowell?
Yeah. you were asking about the difference between the charter schools and the traditional public schools. Charter schools are public schools, but
right.
And the points of contention. Charter schools have the facts on their side. The other side has the rhetoric. And there are far more people who hear the rhetoric than there are who hear the facts, which is the reason for writing the book in the first place. The rhetoric says, look, when you put them all together nationwide, charter schools and traditional public schools, there's really not much difference. And in a sense, that's true, but it's like many things that are true and totally misleading. White students plus Asian students are a majority of the students in traditional public schools nationwide. Black students plus Hispanic students are a majority of the students in charter schools nationwide. Now, for years, generations, white students and Asian students have been scoring higher than black students and Hispanic students. Now, when the charter schools come along and close the gap, the people say, well, the charter schools are no better than the others. If they're no better than the others, how come the others had this huge gap for generations on end, and now the charter schools have closed the gap? My book, the data I collect, compares students who are comparable. That is, in more than 100 New York City schools, there are charter schools and traditional public schools holding classes in the same building. And in almost all the cases, in all the cases in my sample, blacks and Hispanic add up to a majority in both kinds of schools. And so we're now comparing comparable populations in comparable neighborhoods going in the same building. And when you do that, you find that statewide mathematics test, 10% of the students in the traditional public schools in those buildings pass the math test. And in the charter schools, 68%.
Right. So my question, or at least in my mind, was what do they do better? Since they're also publicly funded, what do they do better?
An excellent question that really I didn't think of in those terms. And one very big difference is this. Traditional public schools are unlike virtually any other institutions I can think of offhand. Every kind of institution, whether it's a sports league, it's a medical facility, a church, automobile dealerships, they have a clientele. And they must attract that clientele and hold that clientele if they want to survive as institutions. That is not true of traditional public schools. Compulsory attendance laws means they are supplied with a clientele regardless of whether they educate them properly or don't. Public schools don't even compete with each other because each one has a monopoly in some particular territory.
It's perfectly, it's so obvious. They don't have to compete in terms of excellence.
That's right. Or even competence. Never mind excellence,
goodness. You're right. That's fair.
I threw those figures out there, which show that kids in the charter schools in New York City, which is where I got my sample, passed this math test nearly seven times as often as the kids in the same building in the same classes taking the same test.
Has anyone of the enemies of the charter schools debated you?
No, they have not. I would be surprised if they did.
I would be shocked. I would help sponsor it monetarily.
Oh, it sounds like a great idea.
Yeah, of course it's a great idea. But as I tell my listeners all the time, the left doesn't debate, they smear. So
they silence, which is the main thing. I'd be very surprised if my book gets reviewed in places like the New York Times.
No, of course. That's correct.
New York Review of Books. I don't even get criticized.
That's right. That is correct.
90% of all criticism that I receive is from my junior assistant, whose job it is to go through my stuff.
Oh, that's funny. That is funny. Not your wife?
Wives have been known to say a few negative things now and then. Shocking as that may be.
Totally. I'm sorry I raised the issue. When I look at the public school, I report regularly about the curricula that they now advance. I'm curious if this has made its way into charter schools. For example, the 1619 rewriting of American history, is that that will be now normative in American public schools. Will that be taught in charter schools?
In California, I suspect it will be. The new legislation last year that I referred to is imposing on charter schools the same bad practices that are in the traditional public schools. See, the idea behind charter schools initially was that they would be freer to experiment since they wouldn't be covered by all the minute regulations that apply to the traditional public schools. And if they came up with things that were successful educationally, then the traditional public schools would have the option of adopting these things. What has happened has been the exact opposite, that when the charter schools come up with something that contributes to their turning out a better educational result, the backlash is to impose restrict the charter schools and impose the things that are failing in the traditional public schools. For example, the new legislation last year makes it virtually impossible to seriously punish any student who simply disrupts the classes or the schools that they're in. Now, one of the things that charter schools do is have some sense of discipline so that kids who are, you know, act out, hit other kids, yell and carry on so the class can't go on, they can be suspended. Now, they cannot be under California law.
More with Thomas Sowell. His important book is up. Senior fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford, a photographer. By the way, what camera are you using lately?
It's the Nikon D, my goodness, 750. It's been so long since I used it, I had to hesitate.
And why is that? Because of the lockdown?
Partly, but also medical things as well. I was diagnosed with pneumonia on Christmas.
On Christmas?
Yes.
How are you now?
Oh, I'm in good shape now.
That is good to hear. I have a number of calls here, which some people just hung up. I'm not sure why. Maybe they thought they wouldn't get on. So I'll take a challenge here from Cannon City, Colorado. Cindy, you're on with Dennis Prager and Thomas Sowell.
Hi, thanks. This is Cindy. It's an honor to talk to both of you.
Thank you.
I have a wonderful sister who is a school teacher, and I always bring up this conversation with her that she doesn't support charter schools. She teaches in the public school system. And she says that charter schools are not required to take developmentally delayed children or challenged children, and that's why they always perform so well, and I don't know how to answer her.
Thank you.
Well, if you get a copy of my book, and you can get one in the library if you don't want to buy it, just look in the back of it, and among the many tables in the appendix is one on children with special needs. That argument has been made by a lot of people. You really can't explain a difference of one school passing the math test at nearly seven times the rate of the others because they have different proportions of disabled or students with disabilities. But the charter schools do, in fact, have students with disabilities. Nationwide, according to Professor Diane Ravitch of NYU, who is a big opponent of charter schools, 11% of the children in traditional public schools nationwide are special disabilities, and only 8% in the charter schools. Now, you're not going to say that a 3 percentage point difference between the two kinds of schools
yes.
can explain away
right. seven,
why
seven
one
times.
School
right.
can pass the math test.
Right.
The other thing that I looked up, although this is not in this edition of the book, I looked up CES Academy schools, of which there were 13 in my sample, and the percentage of special needs to students ranged in those schools from 4% to 34%. So, you know, there's one school that has less than the national average. There's one that has three times the national average. And the one that has three times the national average of students with disabilities has this, you know, more than three quarters of all their students not only reach proficiency, they reach the level above proficiency. So So it really, that is an extremely weak argument, although it's one that is out there, and in most cases, there's nobody to answer
it. That's right, nobody to answer it. That's why I really urge people, for the sake of education in America, to buy the book. Not just get it, look, read it, obviously, but I don't even know who takes books out of libraries anymore. I was very disturbed to learn, and I should have known this, I guess, but I didn't know it, to learn from you last segment that charter schools can be told what to teach just as public schools can. So,
yes, and in California, they have already been mandated to teach what is called sex education. It's really sex indoctrination.
Yes.
And the new legislation, I believe, is included. They're going to be required to, and it's not that they are given that as a subject to teach. It is specified what particular material they must use.
Well, in light of that, I'm really confused as to why they do better. If they're told what to teach.
Well, this is a new development.
Oh, really?
Yes. So it's when Jerry Brown was governor, the one of the few good things he did was resist the effort of people to force the charter schools to teach and specify sex education. It's one thing to say you must teach a class on sex education and leave it up to you to decide how to do it.
Oh.
No. The and so they have, I mean, some of these things in the sex education classes, they have a model of a penis, and all the 11-year-olds are supposed to go up there and put a condom on it. And they'll have two classes. There'll be
All right, hold on a moment, if you would, Tom Sowell. Again, folks, this critical book, Charter Schools and Their Enemies, up at DennisPrager.com. So what happened? Charter schools were allowed to teach the way they wanted, but now it's in California, it's imposed that they have to teach basically what public schools do.
Well, they're not in everything, but they've intruded what is called sex education, but what is really pretty gross stuff to be forced on 11-year-old kids. And that is prescribed. It's not, as I say, they don't tell you to teach sex education and let you decide what you're going to teach. They have their program all set up, and that's what you are forced by law to teach. The same thing with what is called ethnic studies, which is apparently, from all that I've heard about it, very much along the lines of the 1619 project.
Yes.
At the New York Times.
Yeah.
Which I would be shocked that they got a Pulitzer Prize for it. But there was once a New York Times reporter who got a Pulitzer Prize for denying that there was a famine in the Ukraine.
That's right. Walter Duranty, 1932.
And 6 million people died.
That's right.
In this famine that that's he claimed didn't exist.
Yes, this is not new, unfortunately. Where is... there was a person... It happens so often that the call I want to take hangs up. They give up. Somebody was calling in to say that what's being taught today, at least in her experience, is hatred of white people. Does that resonate?
Yes. That's common. Yeah, in other words, and more generally, the word privilege is used as a substitute for achievement. So anybody who has achieved something will be said to be privileged. And some even apply that to middle-class blacks. That privilege? I mean, the ancestors brought here as slaves and they're privileged? I mean, what are you talking about? But the idea of achievement is really a deadly idea to those who believe in the social justice vision. Because the argument is that if you're not doing well, then what you lack is somebody else's fault. And that's not necessarily even tied to race. I mentioned in the book in passing that the very same kinds of indoctrination goes on in England, where the underclass is predominantly white, and you get exactly the same kinds of results. That studies in England show, they break down all the low-income people into different ethnic groups in England. And which ethnic group do you think does the worst on tests? Native-born white Britons, people who come in from Africa, from the Caribbean, from India, from China, all and are in that same low income bracket, all do better than whites in the same bracket. The Economist magazine recently pointed out that that white students in one of these boroughs score lower than black students in any borough around London.
How does the left explain that in Britain?
They don't. What the difference is, these people who come in, they may be poor in terms of money and so on, but they have not been subjected to generations-long indoctrination in the idea of grievance.
I want to ask you about, I mention this constantly on my show, about 2 million sub-Saharan Africans, that means black Africans, have moved to the United States in the last 50 years.
Uh-huh.
How are they doing?
I don't have the figure on all of them. What I know about Nigerians is they're doing quite well. Haitians, of all people, who are quite poor in Haiti, come here and they prosper.
If I took an anonymous vote among African immigrants of the last 50 years, and Haitians for that matter, and said yes or no, the United States is systemically racist, what do you think the vote would be?
There is actually tension between native-born black people and black immigrants to the United States. And some years ago, someone checked on the blacks at Harvard and some other elite schools, and they found that most of the blacks were not native-born black Americans. They were black immigrants who took up a disproportionate share of the affirmative action places put aside for people who are supposedly the descendants of slaves, which these other people were not.
It's fascinating. Detroit, Yolanda. Hello, Yolanda. You're on with Dennis Prager and Tom Sowell.
Hi, Dennis. Thank you for taking my call.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Mr. Sowell, for your book. I have a daughter, my one and only child, who, thank God, was able to go into charter school from kindergarten, K through 12. It was a blessing because I was so concerned about putting her in school. My husband and I couldn't afford a private school, so I was really challenged in finding a public school. So needless to say, long story short, the charter schools were just coming about. This was in 1998. And I went to an informational meeting, and I was sold immediately. One thing that you said is so true. They did not, at that time, try to tell them what they could teach.
Yeah, we'll leave it at that. We'll be. Lisa is a teacher in Columbus, Ohio, says charter schools are only marginally better than public. Why advocate? But I mean.
Well, I don't think passing a math test at nearly seven times the rate of the public schools is marginally better. It's amazing how much rhetoric there is out there without one speck of facts behind them.
That's why the book is so important. Betsy, quickly, in Cleveland, hi.
Dr. Sowell, one of my greatest wishes is being fulfilled right now, speaking to you, sir.
What am I, chopped liver?
No, Dennis, I love you too. But to get to talk to Dr. Sowell,
no,
please.
I'm with you. Go ahead.
And I want to rush because I know there's no time on the clock. First, I want everyone to know that he's 100% correct with regard to the California health education, is what they're calling it, and bullying curriculum. It includes lewd and lascivious information. And it's being shared, Dr. Sowell, beginning in kindergarten, not 11-year-olds. Kindergarten, which is age 5. So I did want to let you know that. I am a consulting psychologist to one charter school here in Cleveland. We have a plethora of charter schools. This one stands alone and has one founder. Sadly, she has chosen to teach black history to the exclusion of white history. And I'm sorry to say this, but the students, who are great kids, it's a middle school and high school only, are being taught to hate white people in cooperation with what Black Lives Matter espouses. So I wanted to understand what I might do.
Okay, Tom.
Boy, unfortunately, this is happening. I think just letting the public know the extent to which this is already happening. And there's a backlash, as I've said, across the country against charter schools because there's money involved. One of the things that shocked me in doing the research is how many places there are vacant schools, schools that have been vacant for years, and they will block the charter schools from using them because that means the charter schools can take students from off the waiting list and teach them in these schools. In some places, they have actually demolished the schools to make sure the charter schools can't get them.
Well, again, though, if they're teaching what the public schools are increasingly because of being forced to do so.
No, that battle is still being... In California, that battle has been lost.
Yes,
but it's a battle elsewhere. There's hope.
Tom, we have to speak more often. A belated happy birthday to you.
Thank you.
A big hello to your wife. Stay well.
Thank you. You too.
Thank you.